Certain Proverb, you are on to FCFM. On Twitter, something that is about the time is 9:30. Our next program is Islamic Education 1-2-2. Have a listening.
Students, I am Mrs. Suzanne Sleman from Integrated Science Department. I will be here with you today to continue with our radio presentation, which we started earlier.
Sorry, I apologize for the announcing the program. Our next program is Integrated Science 1-2-2. Happy listening.
Remember, in our last session, we were able to look at the concept of photosynthesis, what it entails, the conditions necessary for it to occur, and also its importance to life in general. Now, today we'll be looking at the concept of combustion and respiration. Now, to start with, the term combustion, it means the burning of a substance in the presence of air, that is oxygen. Now, most substances born in air is a chemical reaction that is frequently accompanied by the production of light and heat. Now, during this reaction, the combustible material usually combines with atmospheric oxygen to form oxide and other products. Now, for example, when you burn candle, your candle wax, and then maybe you ignite it, it melts, vaporizes, and decomposes into its constituent elements, mainly hydrogen and carbon. This then combines with atmospheric oxygen during the process of burning to produce water and carbon dioxide, respectively. Now, when the supply of oxygen is limited, it results in an incomplete combustion of carbon, with the result that can either be carbon monoxide or black particles of carbon soot may be produced. Now, with this, we can therefore look at the concept of addition and removal of oxygen, otherwise known as oxidation and reduction reaction. Now, oxidation reactions are two opposing yet complementary processes. Now, the term oxidation reaction is described as a reaction in which oxygen combines with a substance, whereas a reduction reaction in which oxygen is removed from a substance. Now, the substance that donates oxygen is termed as oxidizing agent, while the substance that accepts oxygen is the reducing agent. Now, for example, in a reaction between zinc oxide and carbon, in this reaction, where zinc oxide reacts with carbon, the zinc oxide donates oxygen to carbon, and therefore, hence, the carbon is oxidized to carbon dioxide, while zinc oxide is reduced to zinc. Now, it can also be seen in terms of removal of hydrogen. Now, these are reactions involving the transfer of hydrogen. Hence, oxidation is defined as the removal of hydrogen, while reduction is the addition of oxygen. Example, a reaction between hydrogen sulfide and chloride. Now, in this reaction, hydrogen sulfide gas normally loses hydrogen to chloride and becomes oxidized, while chlorine gas gains or accepts hydrogen and becomes reduced. So we can therefore say that, in summary, any oxidizing agent is an electron acceptor. It is also a substance which is reduced in a reaction, and it can also be seen as a substance in which oxidation number decreases, whereas any reducing agent is an electron donor. It's also seen as a substance which is oxidized in a reaction, and it's also a substance in which the oxidation number increases. Now, certain substances can act both as oxidizing and reducing agent depending on the reaction condition. For example, water acting as an oxidizing agent in a reaction between water and carbon. It oxidizes carbon. It can also act as a reducing agent in a reaction between water and fluorine, reducing fluorine. Hence, to determine the behavior of a substance in a redox reaction, you must carefully examine the reaction. Now, with this regard, on the other hand, respiration can be seen as a biochemical activity of the cell in which glucose is broken down by a series of reactions controlled by enzymes to release energy. Now, respiration takes place in two separate phases or stages. These are external respiration and internal respiration. External respiration is defined as exchange of gases between the environment and the respiratory organs of living organisms. In simple terms, it means breathing in of air or oxygen into the respiratory organs, whereas otherwise known as inspiration or inhalation, and breathing out of carbon dioxide and water vapor in a process called expiration or exhalation. Now, the second phase or second stage is the internal or tissue respiration. Now, this is defined as the oxidation of organic food substance within the cells of an organism, resulting in the release of energy, carbon dioxide, and water. It takes place when oxygen taken in is utilized for the oxidation of food substance in the individual cells. In summary, the main aim of respiration is the generation of energy required by the individual for life processes. Now, internal respiration is also divided into two, namely aerobic respiration and anaerobic respiration. Now, aerobic mode of respiration is a respiration in a mode of respiration which requires oxygen. It commonly occurs in plant and animal cells. Hence, it could also be referred to as a cellular respiration. Internal tissue respiration involves series of chemical reactions involving the breakdown of glucose by respiratory enzymes, resulting in the release of energy. Now, tissue respiration occurs in the mitochondria of cells of plants and animals. Those organisms that undertake this mode of respiration are called aerobes, hence the name aerobic respiration. Examples include most plants and animals. Therefore, we can see respiration or aerobic respiration happens between or takes place between glucose and oxygen, in the sense that it gives rise or produced water and carbon dioxide, and in the process, energy is being liberated. And whereas the second phase or the second stage or second type of respiration, otherwise known as anaerobic respiration, is a mode of respiration that does not require oxygen. Now, such organisms are called anaerobic. Examples are fungi, some bacteria, and endoparasites. The common and end point is always alcohol, and energy is also liberated, likewise carbon dioxide. Now, in both aerobic and anaerobic respirations, the first step is the splitting of glucose by an oxidative process, now resulting in the production of simple compound called pyruvic acid. Now, this pyruvic acid is being produced in a process called glycolysis. Now, glycolysis is a process of partial breakdown of food substance, mainly glucose, to release energy. It does not require oxygen, but require enzymes that are located in the cytoplasm. In anaerobic respiration, the pyruvic acid is further broken down in a series of oxidative reactions that are catalyzed by enzymes to produce carbon dioxide and water. Energy is further released. Now, this second reaction is called Krebs cycle or tricarboxylic acid cycle. Krebs cycle is the complete breakdown of pyruvic acid to release energy. It also takes place in the mitochondria of cells. Now with that, we can also look at the conditions necessary for photosynthesis. Now for efficient respiration, there is need for 1. Respiratory medium, 2. Respiratory organs, 3. Transport medium, 4. Ventilation, 5. Respiratory surface. Let me explain it one after the other. Now respiratory medium. This refers to the surrounding of the organism from which it obtains oxygen, example air and water. Secondly, the respiratory organs. Now this refers to the organs responsible for respiration, such as the gills, lungs, stomata, and lenticels. Now thirdly, we have the transport medium. This is the system that moves the dissolved gases around the body, example blood. 4. Ventilation. Now this is referred to as the movement of water or air in one direction over the respiratory surface. This helps to renew the air or water in contact or near a respiratory surface. Then number 5, the respiratory surface. This is referred to as the definite surface of the body, such as the lungs or gills, where gaseous exchange takes place. Now, types of respiratory organs. Different organisms do have different types of respiratory organs. For example, the unicellular organisms. Their respiratory organ is mostly the body surface. Then we have organisms such as the hydra and tapeworm, which normally respire through the cell membrane by the process of diffusion. Then we have the earthworm, which respire with the help of its wet skin or body surface. Then we have the arthropods, such as insects, which make use of a tracheal system. Then we have the amphibians, such as the toad and frog, which normally respire through their gills, mouth, skin, and lungs. Then we have the fish, which also respire through gills. Then we have the reptiles. They make use of the lungs as respiratory organ. Then we have the apes or birds, which respire through their lungs. Then we have the mammals, and their respiratory organ is the lung. Now, having seen that, we can therefore look at the mammalian respiratory system. Now, the mammalian respiratory system includes the nasal passage or nostrils, the larynx, the trachea or the windpipe, the bronchus, and the alveoli. Now, the nostrils lead into the posterior portion of the mouth cavity called the pharynx, and this also lead into the larynx or voice box. Now the larynx leads into the windpipe or the trachea. A flat piece of tissue, otherwise known as the epiglottis, covers the entrance of the larynx to prevent food particles from entering into the larynx and trachea when food is swallowed into the esophagus, which lies just behind the trachea. Now the trachea branches into two, the bronchi. And both the trachea and the bronchus have rings of cartilage which strengthen them and prevent them from collapsing when the pressure of air inside is low. Each bronchi leads to the lungs, where it branches into smaller tubes, and this also has numerous air sacs called alveoli. The alveoli are also richly supplied with blood particles and are also sites or surfaces where gaseous exchange takes place. The alveoli are communicated with the atmosphere through the continuous air passage leading from them to the bronchi, trachea, larynx, pharynx, and also the nostril. So with that, we can therefore say that the process or the mechanism involved in respiration in mammals can be summarized as follow. Now, the one, there are two phases in the breathing process. We have the inspiration or inhalation, when atmospheric air is breathed in, and exhalation or expiration, when carbon dioxide is breathed out. In the process of this inspiration, the following normally takes place. That is, one, the diaphragm contracts and flattens out. Then secondly, the intercostal muscles, that is those muscles between the ribs, contract and they are being raised. Then we have the sternum moves forward, and then the volume of the thoracic cavity increases and pressure in the lungs is lowered. Air from outside rushes in through the nose and fills the alveoli. Whereas in the process of expiration, the sequence is as follows. The diaphragm relaxes and returns to its normal dome shape. Then the intercostal muscles relaxes. Ribs are also lowered. The sternum moves backwards. Now the volume of the thoracic cavity also decreases and the pressure in the lungs is increased. Air is expelled from the lungs through the nose. So with that, that is that for the mammalian respiratory system. Now for plants, they also do respire. Now plants, even though they are less active than animals, because plants have less oxygen demand. They have no specific respiratory organs. This is because sufficient atmospheric gas enters the plant through special openings, such as one, the stomata and the lenticels. Now the stomata are located on leaf surfaces and young stem, whereas the lenticels situated in gaps in the back of woody stems and in young roots. Now this occur as a result of diffusion from salt water through the root hairs. Now the sequence of the gaseous exchange in plant is as follows. 1. Oxygen diffuses in through stomata and lenticels into intercellular species. Now this is also conducted through the plant in the numerous tunnels from air spaces in the parenchyma. And oxygen now dissolves in moisture around the cells, diffuses into cytoplasm of the cell, where the concentration of oxygen is lowest, as it is continuously used for respiration to produce carbon dioxide. Now, carbon dioxide produced during this process makes the concentration in the cell high, thus makes it to diffuse across the cell membrane and cell wall into the intercellular species and out through the stomata and lenticels. So with that, we have come to the end of today's presentation. And my contact, as usual, is 080-36-94-9379. If there is any question, or if there is any addition, or if there is any problem, then you can contact me through this number. Till we meet again.
I'm just sitting here playing the guitar.
That was Integrating Science Camp 2 from FCFM 122.